بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue tonight to read المثنوي العربي النوري of سيدي بديع زمان النورسي. And Brother Talha last few days was commenting on the methodology we are following. And he was saying that we should stick more to the text and read more of the text. And I was explaining to Brother Talha that the reason we are not sticking to the text is the fact that there is a need for a lot of prolegomena or preliminaries, without which it's very difficult to understand the book. And though we have been doing very close line by line exegesis and unpacking many of the things in the sentences, so in a sense we were sticking maybe too much to the text, we did diverge and go into many sometimes rather abstract concepts. But the purpose of all of that was to prepare ourselves for the actual reading of the text. So I will listen to your advice and hope that I will be doing more reading of the Rasail, the Mathnawi al-Arabi al-Nuri. One of the things I would like to say is that, you know, normally when people read Rasail al-Nur, they simply read the Rasail. And there might be a little bit of explanation, but it's mainly the Rasail themselves that they read. This is a different text. It's very packed. It's very much an incubator, as we were saying, and a seedling of all the Rasail al-Nur. And there is a lot of unpacking to do as you study. So it's slightly different. It's quite a bit different than reading Rasail al-Nur. Also, I'm of the view, and this is my own personal opinion, that today there is a great need for the opening up of the reading of the Rasail al-Nur, meaning that we must not just stick with the text of the Rasail, but actually look at what other people are writing and saying, especially in the tradition. Because unfortunately, some people are so devoted to Badi'u Zaman Nursi Rahmatullahi Alayh that they just stick with the text itself and are not even willing to read Imam Ghazali or Imam Rabbani, or which was not the intention of Ustaz, I don't think, and is not conducive to the development and the growth of the Nursi movement. So I believe that there has to be a lot of kind of opening up. And in some of the remarks I was making, I was trying to make the Mathnawi touch the horizon, say, of phenomenology at times, of existentialism at times, of Greek philosophy at times, trying to just give the contemporary reader and listener more windows onto the literature of Nursi, so that it's not just something of the past, but something that's quite current and present for them. So I hope that it was okay. But nevertheless, today we will begin reading the actual Lama'at min Shams al-Tawheed, which are illuminations of the from the sun of unification or unity or belief in unity, tawheed. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Fi bayan jawahir min khaza'in hadhihi al-ayat. So the Shaykh is going to explain or explicate, to give bayan, explication of jawahir, of essences or jewels from the treasures, khaza'in, of these ayat. Which ayat is he going to give exegesis of? He's going to give exegesis of the following ayat. A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Allahu khaliqu kulli shay, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in wakil. Allah azza wa jal creates everything and he is the custodian of everything. Lahu maqalidu samawati wal ard. He has control over the heavens and the earth. And this is in Zumur, Ayah 62 and Ayah 63. And then, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون. Praise be to He who has the control over all things, and to Him and to whom you return. And again, وإن من شيء إلا عندنا خزائنه. For everything we have the treasure boxes or the safes in which valuable things are kept. And then again, ما من دابة إلا هو آخذ بناصيتها. Nothing that moves except that he has control over it. So this is, these are ayat about divine power and divine management and divine control of the universe. And this chapter is about these topics. Ya ayyuha al-ghafil al-munghamis fil asbab. He is calling the people like myself, whom he calls ghafil. Ghafil is from ghafla. Ghafla is to fail to pay attention, to be distracted. Okay? And the ghafil is the distracted one. Who is the distracted one? He is the one who is distracted from Allah Azza wa Jal, from feeling the reverence for the Creator as he lives amongst the creatures. So if I live in this life paying attention only to the created and never thinking of the Creator, then I am ghafil. So he says, Ya ayyuhal ghafil. He is speaking to the distracted, to people like myself who are often distracted from paying attention to their Creator. Al-munghamis fil asbab, who is drenched in or right in the middle of asbab. Okay, munghamis is to be like a, you know, you take something, you put it in a liquid. You basically, what's the English word? Submerged. Yeah. So you are submerged in the asbab. Asbab is the plural of sabab, and sabab is often translated cause. So you are submerged in the world of causality. What does he say to this distracted person? He says, Ya ayyuha al-ghafil al-munghamis fil asbab, inna al-asbaba hijabu tasarruf al-qudra. These causes, these asbab, are the veil that are actually, are the veils that are hiding tasarruf al-qudra. The actual, this is very difficult to translate. Al-Qudra is the divine power, the divine ability. And tasarruf is actual manipulation of things, is the actual control of things, is the actual will over things. Okay? From sarafa is to make something move from this side to this side, to direct things from this to that. So the directedness of the power of God. Okay? So this is his definition of causality or causes. Causes are basically the veils that hide, okay, the directedness or the directing that belongs to the power of the of God. يا أيها الغافل المنغمس في الأسباب إن الأسباب حجاب تصرف القدرة. Okay, meaning that the power of God is actually controlling things, directing things, and this directedness or this directing is actually hidden away from you and I, okay, through the veils that are called causes. Meaning, behind every cause, there is divine power and will and divine management of the universe. And yet, we are distracted in a way by the seeming causes of these things. So that when the fire causes the burning, okay, it looks like the fire is the one that's doing the burning. While in fact, it is God's creativity that's actually doing the burning. And the fire is only a cause, an apparent cause. So the fire becomes a veil that hides away the actual activity of the divine. Okay? يا أيها الغافل المنغمس في الأسباب إن الأسباب حجاب تصرف القدرة. Okay? We're not doing so badly, brother Talha. This is two sentences now. إذ العزة والعظمة تقتضيان الحجاب. This is because the dignity and the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal تقتضيان الحجاب, make the veiling necessary. Okay? Now, necessary here has to be taken with a grain of, with a what do you call it? A pinch of salt, or grain of salt, you say? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Meaning, there is no necessity upon Allah Azza wa Jal. It is Allah Azza wa Jal that makes things necessary or not necessary. But for him, nothing is necessary. Okay? Everything is possible. Of course, there is an exception to this, which is called the category of impossibilia. For example, creating a stone that he himself cannot lift. That's an impossibility. But it's not an impossibility in the common sense of impossibility. It is because such a matter would not even fall under the will. It cannot even arise. Okay, so it is impossible in that sense of not being able to arise in the first place. And that is why the mashayikh say the qudra cannot be linked to the impossibilia. It cannot here does not mean it's not an inefficiency in the will. It is an impossibility inherent in the impossibilia. These are things that are impossible. For example, a stone that Allah cannot lift, for example, would belong to the world of impossibilia. Okay? And such a world can never be subject to will. Okay? But the can never be here is not an inability in the will. It's an impossibility inherent in the thing. I know this is a bit maybe complicated, but it's an important doctrine in scholastic exegesis, actually, not only for Muslims, but for Christian scholasticism, even Thomas, and even Jewish scholasticism, Hasdai Karaskas and other scholars. Again, this topic is what do you do with impossibilia? And is everything possible for Allah Azza wa Jal? And yes, everything is possible, except that the impossibilia, okay, which are inherently so because of contradiction, okay, would not be subject to divine will. لا تتعلق بها القدرة. Okay, لا تتعلق بها القدرة. This is not for lack of قدرة, okay, of ability or power, but for the inherent impossibility of the thing itself. Okay, so he says, يا أيها الغافل المنغمس في الأسباب إن الأسباب حجاب تصرف القدرة إذ العزة والعظمة تقتضيان الحجاب. The reason I needed to explain that is because تقتضيان here, okay, make it necessary, does not mean that Allah عز وجل is subjected to necessity. Okay, because he is. And this is an incredibly important doctrine in Islam. Allah Azza wa Jal is, as per the Quran, فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدٌ. He does whatever he wills. Okay? So, فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدٌ. That's very, very important. Part of the reason Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah, and these are the Asha'ira, who are the Shafi'iyya and the Malikiyya in Aqaid, and the Maturidiyya, who are normally the Ahnaf, and also the Hanabila, and we call this grouping Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, all of them strongly stress this doctrine of fa'alun lima yurid, following the Quran, that Allah does what he wills. You cannot bind Allah Azza wa Jal by something outside of him. Okay, that's a very important doctrine. This is contrary to the Mu'tazilites or the Mu'tazili school, because the Mu'tazili school thought of reason, okay, as being in a way so general, so absolute, that it was binding for Allah himself. So they would say that Allah must do the aslah, that which is best. Okay, and the Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe that Allah does what he wants and wills. Okay, and that which Allah wills to be good is good, and that which Allah wills to be bad is bad. There is no good or bad outside of Allah that's binding to him. Nor is there a reason that is beyond Allah that's binding to him. It is he who in his utter power, okay, is able to do what he wants and wills. And and wants here does not mean deficiency, meaning irada, not need. Okay?
يا أيها الغافل المنغمس في الأسباب، إن الأسباب حجاب تصرف القدرة، إذ العزة والعظمة تقتضيان الحجاب.
This is, I'm just trying to make sure we don't fall into the wrong meaning of تقتضيان. Maybe I've caused the wrong meanings by explicating it. But it's very important that we are careful when speaking about our Lord عز وجل. Okay? سبحانه وتعالى.
يا أيها الغافل المنغمس في الأسباب، إن الأسباب حجاب تصرف القدرة، إذ العزة والعظمة تقتضيان الحجاب.
So the majesty and the glory or power of Allah عز وجل makes حجاب necessary. And all the qualifications I made regarding necessary here. Okay.
لكن المتصرف الفعال هو القدرة الصمدانية.
That which truly is manipulating things and changing things and directing things and managing things effectively, فعال. Okay. What is that? القدرة الصمدانية. The power of the sublime Lord Allah عز وجل. Okay. So who is the real doer, maker, changer, manager, controller of everything? It is Allah Azza wa Jal and only Allah Azza wa Jal.
Okay. إذ التوحيد والجلال هكذا يقتضيان.
This is because توحيد, unification of Allah Azza wa Jal, والجلال, His glory, His magnificence, His utter power, هكذا يقتضيان. Make that sensible, make that logical, make that necessary. يقتضيان again. Okay, having qualified the word, I can now use it.
إذ سلطان الأزل له مأمورون لكن ليسوا وسائط الإجراء حتى يكونوا شركاء سلطنة الربوبية.
Okay, you wanted to stick with the text, Talha, so that's what we're doing.
Okay, لكن okay, he says إذ سلطان الأزل له مأمورون. The Sultan, the Sultan, the ruler of eternity, Allah Azza wa Jal, له مأمورون.
He does have things or beings or entities or causes that he commands. مأمورون from أمرا, to command. Commanded beings. Okay?
لكن ليسوا وسائط الإجراء. But these are not mediators of procedures.
They are not procedural mediators, meaning they are not the ones who are doing on God's behalf. This is very important. Mediation for Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah is very particular. There is no inherent power in that which mediates. This is contrary to some different schools within Islam. For example, some of the Mu'tazilites, not all, had that doctrine. And also Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, this is very clear from his Fisal, في الملل والنحل, does believe in the tabai' that are inherent in things. And does believe in wasa'it that are of this kind that the Shaykh is rejecting. His position is typically Ash'arite and Maturidi, which is Ahl Sunnah wa Jama'ah. Okay?
إذ سلطان الأزل له مأمورون لكن ليسوا وسائط الإجراء.
They are not procedural mediators حتى يكونوا شركاء سلطنة الربوبية. For if that happens, they would be partners in the rule of the Lord or partners in lordly rule. يكونوا شركاء سلطنة الربوبية. They are not like that. What are they like?
بل هم من الدلالين الذين يعلنون إجراءات الربوبية.
They are mere callers who point out the procedures that are actually made by the Lordship himself. Okay? Meaning, and the word here is dallal. Dallal is, I don't know if you're familiar with this concept, but in the gold market, he's somebody who doesn't own the jewelry and he's not buying the jewelry, but simply is a middleman who gets a commission for just pointing the buyer to the seller, a kind of salesperson, a kind of a salesperson that travels back and forth in the old bazaars and souks. So in the gold market in Istanbul, there will be this dallal, okay? And the dallal was a trusted person, but he was neither the buyer nor the seller. nor did he have money, nor did he have the efficacy. Who has the efficacy? It was the owner or the person who's doing the buying. But the dallal himself didn't have anything. Okay? So he uses this word dallal. And dallal is from dalla yadullu dilalatan, which means their sole role is to indicate. So he sees the mediators or the causes as mere indicators. Okay? They are signifiers, indicators, but they are not actually things that have efficacy in themselves. That's a very important doctrine. Again, this is very Ash'ari, very Maturidi, okay? And also very Hanbali, except the Hanabila don't like to talk about it. So they don't actually have a highly developed kalam or ilm kalam, but the Ash'ari and the Maturidi do. This is because of the geography of the madhahib. The Shafi'iyya and the Ahnaf had to encounter many other civilizations and philosophical schools and theological disputations, and so they developed a very intricate kalam, while the Hanabila stuck with the Athar, except for some schools of the Hanabila, like in Baghdad, where they did develop a fairly developed kalam, but a very textually centered one. But this is another complicated story that maybe we can come back to at another point. So he's saying about the mediators, al-wasa'it. He says, لَكِنْ لَيْسُ وَسَائِطَ الْإِجْرَاءِ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا شُرَكَاءَ سَلْطَنَةِ الرُّبُوبِيَّةِ. Okay? They are not mediators in procedures so as to become the partners of the lordly power or lordly rule. بل هم من الدلالين الذين يعلنون إجراءات الربوبية. They are mere indicators who simply announce the procedures and the processes made by the Lord himself, عز وجل. ومن النظار الذين يشاهدون ويشهدون. They are amongst those who are looking. From نظر ينظر نظرا فهو ناظر وهو. When he does a lot of nadar, min al-nuzar, min al-fu'al. It's an exaggerated form. Okay? So, hatta, wa min al-nuzar, al-ladina yushahiduna wa yashhadun. Nadar is to actually contemplate something. It is equivalent to the Greek theoria. Okay? And that is the word, the Greek word from which theory comes. And theatrician, and theorizing. Okay? It is to contemplate mentally, to actually look upon something, to gaze upon a thing such that the essence of the thing would be intellected by you. That is the definition of nadar. That is why the Muslim thinkers were in Abbasid period and after were called nuzar. Okay? And each one of them was nadir, all of them were called nuzar. Alright? And that's why Imam Ghazali calls his book on logic Mihak al-Nazar, the stone with which you test nazar to make sure that you're looking in the right way. Okay? The Mihak is a stone that you use to scratch a piece of metal to see if it's gold or not. Okay? So it's a test stone of sorts. So it's the book is called Mihak al-Nazar. And the plural of those who do or practice nazar is nuzar. So he says that these causes, these asbab, are actually nuzar. They are gazers who look upon, okay, things, who see things. الَّذِينَ يُشَاهِدُونَ They look, يُشَاهِدُونَ is to be intellect, to contemplate, to cognize, okay? And what happens then? وَيَشْهَدُونَ And then they witness. So I see and I witness. So I see first, and that is nadar, that gives me mushahada, gives me shuhud, okay? And then وَيَشْهَدُونَ And witness. And this function of witnessing is extremely important. That part of the reason there are causes or the wisdom in having causes is to have these entities, these mediators that not only indicate Allah Azza wa Jal, but also look upon and gaze upon His
glorious creativity and witness to it and say, look at the greatness of your Lord. So these signs, and again we come back to these ayat or signs, these signs are not only indicative, they're actually indicative to themselves in that they have shuhud, and they are indicative to others in that they ask others to look, they ask others to acknowledge, they ask others to say, yes, this is our Lord Allah Azza wa Jalla who created all this. Okay, so they are both shahid, okay, they are both shahid and mushahid. First mushahid, they see, and then they are shahid. Tamam? وَمِنَ النُّظَّارِ الَّذِينَ يُشَاهِدُونَ وَيَشْهَدُونَ وَيَكْتَسِبُونَ فِي الْإِنْقِيَادِ لِلْأَوَامِرِ التَّكْوِينِيَّةِ عِبَادَاتٍ تُنَاسِبُ اسْتِعْدَادَاتِهِمْ. And as they obey the creative orders of Allah Azza wa Jal, in their obedience to the creative orders of Allah Azza wa Jal, they actually gain acts of worship. This witnessing that we're talking about is a kind of act, it is an act of worship which they gain, not through anything intrinsic that they do, but through Allah Azza wa Jal gifting them with this. Okay? They have kasb, and this is an Ash'ari term which he uses here. يَكْتَسِبُونَ, okay, they gain through kasb, through the obedience, al-inqiyad, lil-awamir, obedience to the orders, al-takwiniyya, the constitutive or creative orders of Allah Azza wa Jal, through this obedience, they gain worship that is appropriate for their competence, for their readiness, isti'dad. Okay? And the plural is isti'dadat. Okay? So they have a kind of readiness or competence. Okay? And through this competence, they obey the constitutive, creative orders of their Lord. And this obedience becomes a gain to them, a kasb to them, and becomes an act of worship for them of their Maker. A little bit convoluted, but you get the idea, I hope. Okay. فهذه الوسائط لإظهار عزة القدرة وحشمة الربوبية. And this is the conclusion. So these mediators, or these middle entities, are entities that are there in order to manifest, لإظهار, from ظهور, ظهر, يظهر, ظهورا, إظهار is to make manifest, okay, عزة القدرة, the glory or the magnificence of the power of Allah عز وجل, وحشمة الربوبية, and حشمة is a very interesting word. حشمة is comes from modesty, from adab, or from being well mannered, being in a being subtle, okay, being not flagrant, being not so obvious, okay. There is a kind of subtlety, okay. Lordship, he's saying, has a subtlety, as if lordship is it manifests itself but also hides itself. It manifests as it hides, and it hides as it manifests. And this dialectic between disclosure and hiddenness is something that he says is intrinsic to this lordship of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a beautiful concept. You know, as one of the sages, I think it is Ibn Atallah Sakandari rahmatullah alayhi, Ibn Atallah Sakandari rahmatullah alayhi says, كيف كيف يخفيه شيء وهو الظاهر في كل شيء. How can anything hide him when he is manifest in everything?
Okay. No. And Nifari rahmatullahi alayhi says, ما أقربك مني وما أبعدني عنك. Oh, how close you are to me and how distant I am from you. You know, this dialectic is very, very important. And خفاء, you know, and ظهور is something that is always happening in life. So sometimes, you know, you the same sky you see every day, but sometimes you have a feeling of manifestation of glory, of creativity, of and a disclosure that's so grand, you know, that at other times you do not see. And it's, if it were always dhuhur, it would be a big problem. And if it were always khafa, it would be a problem. But this dialectic between manifestation and hiddenness is extremely important, just as the dialectic between night and day is very important. Okay. So he's saying that the wasa'it, or these mediating causes, are actually there for manifesting the magnificence of the power of the Lord, at the same time his hiddenness and subtlety, Azza wa Jal. Okay? So we finished the paragraph, Brother Talha, which is great progress, I think. Now you're going to become famous. This is going on YouTube, you know. وَأَمَّا السُّلْطَانَ الْإِنسَانِ فَلِعَجْزِهِ وَاحْتِيَاجِهِ يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى وَسَائِطْ وَمَأْمُورِينَ يَشْتَرِكُونَ فِي سَلْطَنَتِهِ فَلَا مُنَاسَبَ بَيْنَ الْمَأْمُورِ الْإِلَهِ وَالْإِنسَانِ. What we discussed or described was the power and the lordship of Allah Azza wa Jal. If we compare it to worldly power, the sultan of the insan, the power of a mere human being, we'll see that the insan or the human being does need mediators who are actually doing things on his or her behalf. فَلِعَزِّهِ, this is because he has incapacity. وَاحْتِيَاجِهِ, because he has need. يَحْتَاجُ, he needs إِلَى وَسَائِط, he needs mediators. وَمَأْمُورِينَ, and people who go by his command or orders, employees, for example, or helpers, or friends, if you're requesting. Okay, يَشْتَرِكُونَ فِي سَلْطَنَتِهِ, they have a share, a partnership in his lordship. So if there is a king, yes, he rules, but the human king shares some of his kingship with his wazir or with his minister, and the minister shares with his second in command, and that one shares with the eventual soldiers and so on. So everybody kind of empowers the other by losing a bit of his power, sharing that power in a way, delegating that power. But in the case of Allah Azza wa Jal, as he creates these mediators, these causalities or these causes, there is no sharing of power in the sense of giving away any of his power. On the contrary, Allah's power is ultimate and absolute, and nothing has power except Allah Azza wa Jal. That is the meaning of la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, as we had explained in a previous session. There is no capacity, no power, except through Allah Azza wa Jal. So that is the difference between the Sultan Rabbani or Ilahi and the Sultan Insani, the power that is lordly power and human power. وَأَمَّا السُّلْطَانِ الْإِنسَانِ فَلِعَزِّهِ وَاحْتِيَاجِهِ, because he has incapacity and he has need. يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى وَسَائِط, he has a need for mediators. وَمَأْمُورِينَ, those are commanded by him. يَشْتَرِكُونَ, who share, while Allah Azza wa Jal has no sharer. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ, he has no sharer. في سلطنته, in his power. فلا مناسبة, فلا مناسبة, there is no comparison. بين المأمور الإلهي والإنساني, between that which is ordered by Allah Azza wa Jal and that which is ordered by a mere human being. And this لا مناسبة is extremely important. You know, we are humans, so we use human language. If we were Martians, we would be using Martian language, you know? But we're human, and we have to use human language. And when Allah Azza wa Jal in his infinite mercy upon us and compassion, chose to speak to us and to show us the way. He sent us a human being, a prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who spoke to us in our own language, in Arabic, okay, in a human language, okay? Because we are spoken to in a human language, we are spoken to of things divine, of things that are beyond human beings. We must always make allowance for this. We must understand that when we make analogies, we must remember that لله المثل الأعلى, that for Allah Azza wa Jal, He's got the ultimate, beyond all analogy. He transcends analogy. Okay, there is no مثال. ليس كمثله شيء. There is nothing like Him. So we inevitably liken Him to creaturely things by the mere language that we use, by the mere fact that we use human language. There is a likening that's happening, you know. So when we use human language of Allah Azza wa Jal, inevitably we fall into some sort of likening, okay? But you need to take that likening, likening with a grain of salt. You need to take that likening with a qualifier, an overarching qualifier, an ultimate qualifier that dismisses any possibility of anthropomorphism or comparing him to his creatures. عز وجل وتعالى عن ذلك علوا كبيرا. Meaning, you must have the the overarching rule, which is Quranic. ليس كمثله شيء. Nothing is like him. So whenever a thought or word or expression likens him to anything human, you must immediately smash away the likening by remembering that there is no likeness unto him. This is the fundamental doctrine of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah when it comes to sifat, okay? Or the attributes or the characteristics of Allah Azza wa Jal. Expressions of sifat, yes, we take them as they are. And we do not in any way twist them or change them. That is why we are not allowed to speak of Allah Azza wa Jal except the way He spoke of Himself, Azza wa Jal, to His selected creature, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in His ultimate book, the Quran, which is Hudan wa Rahman al-Alameen. But as we use these expressions of Allah Azza wa Jal, we must always remember that ليس كمثله شيء. That is very, very important. To fall into tashbih or tajseem actually is a form of kufr wal-iyadu billah. To actually fall into likening him to his creatures, okay? Making him human, making him anthropomorphic, okay? Or tajseem, or making him bodily, carnal, okay? Is for us kufr wal-iyadu billah. Okay, that is the doctrine of Ahlus Sunnah wa Jama'ah, and it's extremely important. There is no mixing of the Creator with the created. The attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, though human language is used, must always transcend humanity, must always be beyond any human likeness. That is very important, very, very important. It is in many ways, one third of Ilmul Kalam is this. Okay? It's very important. Okay. And there is a huge literature on responding to the Mujassima and the Mushabbiha and so on, you know, from Subki to the great Juwaini to Fakhr Razi to great books written on this. وَأَمَّا السُّلْطَانِ الْإِنسَانِ فَلِعَزْدِهِ وَاحْتِيَاجِهِ يَحْتَاجُ إِلَى وَسَائِطُ وَمَأْمُورِينَ يَشْتَرِكُونَ فِي سَلْطَنَتِهِ فَلَا مُنَاسَبَةَ بَيْنَ الْمَأْمُورِ الْإِلَهِ وَالْإِنسَانِ لَا مُنَاسَبَةَ, there is no comparison. You cannot make comparison between the two kinds of mediation here. Okay? نَعَمْ إِنْ نَظَرَ أَكْثَرُ الْغَافِلِينَ لا يدرك حسن الحادثات ولا يعرف حكمتها فيشتكي بلا حق ويعترض جهلا ف
فوضعت الأسباب لتتوجه الشكاوى إليها. وإذا وفق أحد لدرك الحكمة والحق ارتفعت الأسباب عن نظره.
He says yes, when people are distracted and cannot see the beauty in all that happens and the wisdom in all that happens, they will be complaining. So it's better that they complain against what they think is the cause than to complain about their maker. So it's almost like a buffer, okay, for complaining. Okay, so when we want to complain and nag, we nag against those causes that are somehow buffering so that we are not seeing the divine power that's creating all this. However, for those who do see the wisdom, okay, for those who can comprehend that there is always a wisdom, even if we cannot see it, okay, then all asbab irtafa'at, meaning become suspended in a sense. They can see through the causality, okay? They can see through the causes, okay? And their contemplation is always of their creator. So this is a very important thing. So sometimes, for example, when, and I used this example before, you're giving an injection at the hospital to a child for immunization, they do not see the wisdom in it. And they cry, you know, very loudly. And if you are a very sensitive parent, it's very easy to, you know, cringe from even seeing the child get the injection. But if you do see the wisdom in having that injection, then in the very pain that you are seeing, you can actually, you are pleased that you finally immunized the child and did not, how can I say, miss the time, as often happens with parents, you know, they're a week late and they're freaking out because they think that they're too late, you know, and it's a, so there is this comfort that you feel as a parent, though you can see that there is pain. So sometimes when you see the wisdom in things, there is a soothing feeling that you have. And that is the nadhar of the wise ones, the sages who see wisdom in all that happens. Who see wisdom in all that happens. It does not mean that they are tranquilized and not trying to improve the situation. But in their attempts to improve the situation, they're not so intoxicated with their own judgment that when they fail, they feel so depressed and bad. It's very easy to feel depressed when things are not going well, despite all the attempts that you're making. Very easy to feel depressed. But depression is of shaitan, wal-iyadu billah. It is not a holy feeling. If you are truly a believer in Allah's infinite power, you should not be depressed. Because all that happens is ultimately His doing. And if you cannot have it both ways. You cannot have a God that simply responds to your wants and needs as you see fit. That wouldn't be a true God, would it? A true God is someone who has infinite power and someone which, by definition, you cannot control. So some people, you know, when they do prayers, they think of the divine as almost like they do prayers in a vending machine mode. I do my dua, then where is my coke? You know, I did my thing. Where is what? You know, and it's as if they're trading. You know, and it's the wrong way of doing dua. You know, you do dua because you were asked to, and because you have to, and because it is a form of gratitude to the one who made you. And because Allah told you that He likes to hear you doing dua. So you do it for all those reasons. And yes, you want the thing that you do dua for, but you must be careful not to try to force the divine into the way you want the response to come. So the response, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam explains, may come in ways that you do not foresee. Or may come in warding off bad things that would have happened to you. Or may come in the hereafter, after the Day of Judgment. But inevitably, Allah Azza wa Jal does come through. Except, He likes to surprise us. He doesn't come through the way we want Him to come through, simply because He doesn't do our bidding. He does not obey us, we obey Him. So sometimes people, even religious people, inadvertently end up, you know,
not being properly directed towards their maker. It's almost as if they want to possess their God rather than be possessed by him. And that is a very important mistake that is often made in religiosity. Not only in dua, but sometimes even in ideologies. When I want God to be used as an instrument against my opponent in political elections, for example. That is a disrespectful attitude towards Allah Azza wa Jal. You know? It's when you want to instrumentalize your very maker. Where you want your maker to be at your bidding, that you just ask and you get what you want, the way you want it. That is not a proper abd, rab relationship. You are the servant, he is the Lord. فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدْ. You must maintain the freedom of Allah Azza wa Jal. You know, today people always speak of human rights, my rights, you know. What about divine rights? Allah Azza wa Jal has rights. And what the most important right that he has is that he be worshipped alone. That you don't take other entities or beings or anything and worship it besides him. That exclusiveness belongs to him. That's his right. Okay? And what is your right? And this is in hadith actually. What is your right? It's your right is that if he does that, if you do that, if you make sure that you worship only him, okay, that he would give you Jannah. And notice, it's not your inherent right. It is a right that he chose to give to you. So your rights are actually based on his rights. And that is incredibly important, that human rights are actually based on the fact that he created us. And he endowed us with rights. And he said, this is my creation. Do not kill him. Do not torture him. Do not disrespect him. Do not insult him. Do not fail to give him when he asks you for water or for food or for shelter. So your respect for his creature, okay, is a sign of respect for the one who created him. So to tell me that you are a religious person and that you worship the creator and at the same time humiliate his creation and kill his creation and torture his creation and destroy his creation, what kind of worship is this? I mean, if you truly worship the creator, then you must respect the rights that the Creator has. And one of the rights the Creator has is the right that you do not injure or in any way insult or humiliate or degrade His creation. So it is not that there is no human rights in Islam. There are human rights in Islam, but they are based on the solid foundation of divine endowment. It is because Allah endowed us with all these rights, endowed His creatures with all these rights, that no human being can take them away. They are absolute. Their absoluteness comes from the absoluteness of Allah Himself, not from the United Nations or from a human parliament or from a committee that writes it, but from the absoluteness of Allah Himself. It is He who made the killing of one soul equivalent to the killing of all of humanity. And it is He who made the giving of life to one soul, to the thirsty, to the hungry, okay, to the needy, and likened it to the giving to the whole of humanity. So this is very serious stuff. Meaning, life should be a process of taking care of divine rights, of Allah's rights. That is why Imam Muhasibi, when he wanted to write a book about the spiritual life, he called it Al-Ri'aya li-Huquqillah, minding Allah's rights. Okay? Why? Because all the adab of Islam, all the ethics of Islam, all the values of Islam are really about minding Allah's rights. And a set of rights that are very important for Allah are the rights of His creatures. Not inherent in themselves, but because Allah endowed them with these rights, they become absolute, these rights. Absolute, not humanly absolute, but
because of the absoluteness of the one who gave them to us. So no human being can take them away. Okay?
وَقَدْ قِيلَ بِتَمْثِيلٍ مَعْنَوِيٍ. And it has been said through a kind of virtual analogy. إِنَّ عِزْرَائِيلَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ, that Israel, the angel of death, عليه السلام, اشتكى إليه تعالى. He اشتكى إليه تعالى. He complained to Allah Azza wa Jal, بأن عبادك يشتكون مني في قبض الأرواح. Your servants complain and say that I'm taking away their souls. فألقي إليه. So he was told, إني أضع بينك وبينهم وسائط المصيبات حتى يتوجه شكواهم إليها لا إليك. I shall put between you and them all these calamities as mediators, so that they would complain about the calamities and not complain about you. It is an athar, which is in Hilyat al-Awliya and in Suyuti and al-Hakim al-Tirmidhi. And the point is, perhaps our weak minds do need these barriers, these mediations, these causalities, so that we can complain about this causality or that causality. But as we become more and more mature in life, we achieve a state of rida, of contentment with Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay? يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ اِرْجِعِي إِلَىٰ رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً. This is the ultimate nafs, the nafs al-mutmainnah, where it is content with Allah and Allah is content with it, so that there is no more complaining. If I calculate the percentage of complaining in my own day, I'll find that maybe 70% of my day is complaining. Complaining about this and complaining about that, and worrying about this and worrying about that. And frustration of feeling, why is this not happening though I'm doing this? As if we control things, you know? The fact of the matter is, He Himself, Allah Azza wa Jal, controls all things. Yes, we are ordered to work hard and to do our best. What they now call in management language, due diligence. You know, we have to have due diligence. But just because you have due diligence doesn't mean that things will happen the way you want them to happen. And it's extremely important not to feel frustrated. I say this to you, but it's really, I'm saying it mainly to me, because I think I'm probably the most guilty in this room of this kind of attitude. This continuous complaining, while in fact, a Muslim is supposed to be in constant shukr or gratitude. As a matter of fact, shukr or gratitude is the very essence of Islam. Imma shakiran wa imma kafura, as it says in the Quran. Either a grateful or kafur, you know, from kufr, kafur, fa'ul, which is the exaggerated form of kafara, you know. So, or kafir, kafur is the one who does kufr a lot. Okay, so that's a very bad state. So look at the contrast. It's not iman kufr, it is shukr kufr. This is strange, you say. Why is that? It's because iman is shukr. Okay? Islam is shukr. Ihsan is shukr. As a matter of fact, feeling grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal is the very essence of being a Muslim. So that the ibadat become not like vending machine ibadat, where I'm doing this to get that, but they become continuous gratitude. You do salat because you want to say thank you to Allah Azza wa Jal. You give zakat because you want to say thank you to Allah Azza wa Jal. You do siyam because you want to say thank you to Allah Azza wa Jal. You do hajj because you want to say thank you to Allah Azza wa Jal. Arkanul Islam are arkanul shukr. Okay? And the contrary of shukr is kufr wal-iyadu billah. So if I measure myself with that measure and ask myself, how grateful am I in my life? I find that I fail miserably, you know? I fail miserably. I am often not grateful enough. Though we start every salat with Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah. And we begin every speech with Alhamdulillah, you know? And we begin every khutbah with Alhamdulillah. And we teach our kids, you know, say Bismillah, say Alhamdulillah after you finish. But as we teach our kids, even today I was saying to my little daughter, say Alhamdulillah, say Alhamdulillah. But how much am I implementing this myself? How hamid am I? How much do I really say Alhamdulillah? It's very easy to take a big misbah and look pious and say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. But
do I really say Alhamdulillah with my being? Do I say Alhamdulillah in my deeds? Do I say Alhamdulillah? Do I sleep content at night that Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed me? As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if you have a house that in which you're sheltered, and if you have food that is keeping you from being hungry, you have the whole dunya, جمعت له الدنيا بحذافيرها. You have collected all of that can be collected in dunya. Meaning, what more do you want? How many beds can you sleep on at the same time? How many cars can you drive at the same time? I mean, when we had horses, you could ride two horses at the same time if you are a great knight, but you can't drive two cars at the same time. It's very difficult, you know. So, how many houses can you stay in the same time? How many? And yet we are so driven by this want, and feeling miserable and feeling that we're deficient, that we don't have, though we have plenty, you know. We have plenty. How can we achieve this rida, this contentment? We can achieve it through only one way, and that is to ask Allah Azza wa Jal for it. This is not something you manufacture or you know, you can say it with your tongue, but ask for it. Ask for rida. Because if you get rida, then you don't need anything anymore. Rida is the very absence of feeling of need, you know. So it comes when you have the ultimate feeling of need, and that is the need for Allah only, Azza wa Jal. As Ibn Atallah Secondary says, إلهي أنا الفقير في غناية فكيف لا أكون فقيرا في فقري. I am poor in my richness. How can I not be poor in my poverty? If we achieve this state of feeling your very poverty in the midst of your richness, poverty for Allah Azza wa Jal, not for things of this dunya, then that is the ultimate richness. Al-Hasilu, he says in conclusion, Rahmatullahi alayhi, إن العزة والعظمة تقتضيان وضع الأسباب الظاهرية لرد الشكايات الباطلة. The glory and the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal necessitate the putting in the middle of causes that are apparent so as to be a barrier, okay, when it comes to the false complaints of creatures. ولئلا يرى العقل الظاهري مباشرة يد القدرة بالأمور الخسيسة الجزئية. And so that this superficial intellect or mind does not see the hand of divine power in things that are of minute or micro or base level. ولكن التوحيد والجلال يردان أيدي الأسباب عن التأثير الحقيقي. However, true unification of Allah Azza wa Jal and His glory actually ward away or ward off, okay, the causes from having true efficacy. So true efficacy belongs only to Allah Azza wa Jal. And when we have difficulties with our hearts, we should revert to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he asks Allah Azza wa Jal and he says, Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha. Give our nufus taqwa, you know, and cleanse these nufus because you are the best of cleansers. أنت وليها ومولاها. You are the one to whom these nufus belong, and you are the Lord of these nufus. So it's incredibly important in our prayers and at the end of this dars and in all of our lives that we wrench our heart out, put it between our hands, and give it back to Allah Azza wa Jal and say, I am not able to deal with this heart. I'm not able to purify it or cleanse it. I have emotions that I cannot get rid of. I have hatred, I have feeling of arrogance, I have feeling of greed. I cannot deal with these emotions. You take these emotions, you get rid of them, Allah Azza wa Jal, because you made this heart and you can make a new heart for me. Give me a new heart that is pure, that is kind, that is full of love and compassion. That's the very essence of Islam, the deen of Ar-Rahmat al-Muhda, the gifted compassion. اللهم أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولكافة المسلمين ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم وصلى الله وسلم على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد الصادق الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.